Good afternoon to all of you. So today I am going to present my work which was focused on the understanding of the pathway of secondary metabolite biosynthesis in the medicinal plant Vidania somnifera. This work was carried out during my PhD dissertation in India. So I in the Institute of Medicinal and Aromatic Plants situated in Lucknow city. And this institute, besides its headquarters in Lucknow city, has four more research centers, two in the southern part and two in the northern part of the country. In the world map, India is one of the biggest producers of medicinal plants, and it has significant role in export of the materials, and Europe represents the biggest market of the medicinal plants and their material, especially Germany. So, utilization of medicinal plants as a medicine was a common practice during ancient time, and it made a basis of many sophisticated traditional medicinal system like Ayurveda in India, traditional Chinese medicine in China, in Egypt, and Europe also has a substantial role in development of medicinal in the development of knowledge about the medicinal plants, like a Roman physician who wrote a book, the Materia Medica, was a very popular book for 15,000 years, and it was one of the most important book for the reference of many pharmacological studies. So the question arises that what is the present scenario of medicinal plants now in the days of modern medicines? Is it an old story, or utilizing medicinal plants is an old-fashioned practice? So matter of the fact is that at least 25% of modern pharmaceutical drugs have plant into ingredients or their derivatives. We have some excellent examples that the metabolites isolated from Cathinnus roseus and Texas plant has anti-cancer activities, which are being used nowadays. And morphine is a very well-known painkiller and sedative, which is being used. And the first ever drug was launched from the Raufia Serpentina for anti-hypertension purpose. And from the wild yam, which is being used by the African tribes for contraceptive, the metabolites isolated from wild yam is a precursor of hormone progesterone, which is used by which is used as a contraceptive, and menthol is our very very well integrated in our daily routine, from toothpaste to chewing gums. So what could be a better example than mentioning the name of last year Nobel Prize in the area of medicine that a Chinese physician got by isolating very potent anti-malarial drug Artemisinin from Artemisia annuum. So what makes plants medicinal or therapeutic? So plants produces two varieties of metabolites. Depending on their requirement in the plants, they are called as primary metabolites and secondary metabolites. Primary metabolites are carbohydrate, proteins, lipids, and nucleic acids, which are essential for the plant life, and they provide energy, and they are important for proper growth, development, and reproduction of the plants. But on the other hand, secondary metabolites, which are made up of alkaloids, phenolics, and terpenoids, are commonly used as humans as drug, dyes, and flavor and fragrance factors. So what is of these use of these compounds in the life of plants is still not so clear. So the question arises that why do plants produce so many bioactive compounds? So many researchers believe that secondary metabolites are language of plants to interact with their environment. Plants cannot run away in adverse condition, so they develop defense mechanism, specialized defense mechanism to interact with their environment. For example, secondary metabolites are important for they can act as a defensive agent to the detrimental organism like pathogens and herbivores, and they also act as allelopathic. With allelopathy, they act inhibit the growth of nearby competing plants. They are also signal molecule in very stress abiotic stress conditions. Besides their defensive mechanism, they also have role in attracting pollinators and mycorrhizal fungi for nodule formation. So my study was on the plant of Vidania somnifera, which is geographically distributed in the drier area of the country, and it is commonly known as Ashwagandha in Hindi and winter cherry in English. Because of its overall health benefit values, this plant is often compared with the ginseng plant and often referred as Indian ginseng. So they have many overall health benefits, but the three major benefits are immunomodulatory. It means they can enhance or suppress the immune reaction, immune system of humans, and new topic activity means they can repair the synaptics of nerves. That's why they are being used for Alzheimer's and Parkinson's disease, and they are also having anti-cancerous. Property, and many health benefiting supplements are available in the market. So secondary metabolites, which make so all this biological activity of the plant is attributed to the specific secondary metabolite present in the plant, which is vidanolide, which is a 28 carbon number of steroidal lactone of triterpenoid lineage. They have many epoxy and hydroxyl group, and the rearrangement of these groups can create a variety of different vidanolides. But three major vidanolides, vidaferrin A, vidanolide A, and vidanone, was detected in all the Vidania somnifera plants. So despite being a very important molecules, and their biosynthetic pathway was not so clear. When we started this work, there was little information was available about the biosynthetic pathway of this molecule. Since it has triterpenoid lineage, they have similar biosynthetic pathway as cholesterol in animals. So the basic precursor molecule is isopentylpyrophosphate, which can be synthesized either by cytosol, by mevalonate pathway, or by plastid, by DOXP pathway. And after that, after this IPP is a 5 carbon number of precursor, which after the head-to-tail condensation, they form 10 carbon number of molecule called as geranyl pyrophosphate, and it is 10 carbon number of compound, which is a sesquiterpene, which is a monoterpene, and this is the main. Always used as essential oils. And then after addition of one IPP molecule, they form 15 number of carbon molecules, which is called as permacyl pyrophosphate. So, and this is sesquiterpene, which is a category of drug and essential oils. So our vidanolide has the 28 carbon number. So there is a long procedure, long steps to cyclization and epoxidation and hydroxylation to form the vidanolides, but this pathway is still unknown. So keeping all these facts, my study was can be distributed in two parts. One is to know the overall accumulation of secondary metabolites, that how much accumulation of this vidanolides occur in the different plant parts of the in different plant parts, and which of the tissue system is suitable to isolate these molecules. And it was previously believed that root was the main major source of this metabolite. And but other researchers believe that they synthesize in the shoot and they translocate to the roots. So to know if they are synthesizing to another tissue and translocating to another tissue, we want to do biosynthesis or with analyze during different morphogenetic stages. And for biosynthetic pathway studies, we were interested to know that which of the pathway have the role in biosynthesis of these molecules, and which are the genes involved which are the key genes involved in the biosynthesis, and what are their regulation. So the starting point, and also the salt tolerance of the plants was also an important aspect to know, as they are present in the many drier area. So we wanted to study that how they behave in the salt stress condition, and thus their cell culture has the potential for the biotransformation. So the starting point of this study to generate different tissue system. For that, we utilize tissue culture technique because of the long gestation period between planting and harvesting. And for that, we selected six different elite accessions of Vidania, and we generated multiple shoots and induced the in vitro roots and to get the full plant list. These full plant lists were transferred to the glasshouse for acclimatization, and after that, they were successfully transferred to the field. Then we established root as an organ culture independent to the shoots, and for that we used the in vitro leaves to direct rhizogenesis. While doing this, we observed a very interesting root nodule morphotype, that when we tried to induce this rooting in the different concentration of medium and sugar composition, we found that some of the roots have nodules. While looking closer by electron microscope, we saw that they lost the root hair root formation. This was an interesting result, and my other colleague is working on this direction for the Vidania and other medicinal plants. So we used the normal root for establishing the root as in culture. After that, we wanted to have undifferentiated tissue cells, which is callus and suspension cells. So for that, we used different explants, and we found that leaf was superior in comparison to the other explants to get a higher amount of callus and their proliferation. So we have all kind of tissue system in vitro, and we wanted to know after that what is the vidanolite accumulation in this tissue system. So for that we use two techniques, thin layer chromatography and high performance liquid chromatography. So the vidanolites were extracted and loaded on pre-coated silica plates, and we found that cultures shoot and cultured root have the similar pattern of field root and field root and field shoots. They were compared by the spots of standard three vidanolites, and we also found that callus and suspension culture has the vidanolite production at lower level, which was confirmed by HPLC by the peaks, by comparing the peaks of three standards. And their quantification done by HPLC, and we found that in culture condition, shoots produce a new kind of should produce a high amount of vidanolites, but the pattern was similar to the field shoots, and in roots they produce lesser amount of vidanolites, and callus and suspension culture was also participating in biosynthesis of vidanolites. So we were the first who reported that undifferentiated cellular status of the plants were also able to synthesize secondary metabolites. After that, we wanted to study the metabolite accumulation pattern in all morphogenic stages. For that, we use root as an explant to regenerate the shoots. And we wanted to know the vidanolite accumulation in whole cycle. So this protocol also This protocol also developed to regenerate shoots from the roots, which is being used in our laboratory to generate transgenic plants which were infected by Agrobacterium rhizogens. But my point of interest was to know their vedenolite content. So the HPLC quantification revealed that when the roots were, when we started with the roots, they have similar pattern of roots of field with lower concentration. And when they have the green cells, they have dramatically increased one kind of vedenolite, which after mature stage have different kind of vedenolite, and which were increasing after the maturation of shoots. And this shows a typical content of field shoots. So we conclude here that the pattern of vedenolite accumulation is tightly regulated during the morphogenic stages. And to confirm that, we also did a semi-quantitative expression of pathway putative genes. And for that we choose HNGR, FPPS1S, SS, SE, CAS and GT. So for these, we found that in vitro shoots, roots have the higher expression level of these pathway enzymes, which are correlated with their higher expression as compared to the white calyx. So now we know that the all in vitro tissue system has what kind of vedenolite they have, what is their pattern of accumulation during different transgenic different morphogenic stages. Now for the bud to berry development, we selected 17 different stages to know their vedenolite contents, and we found that at younger stage buds have more vedenolites in comparison to flowers, which and in berry stages they have very low vedenolite content, which was also confirmed by HPLC quantification. So on the whole level of plant, we now know that shoots have higher vedenolites, and followed by buds, and then flowers, and root and berry has the lower lower accumulation. To know the role of pathway putative gene, we did real-time PCR of all pathway putative genes, and we found that in bud stages, all the pathway putative genes have higher expression, which gradually decrease in the maturity of flowers and almost diminished in the berry level. And this result was also presented in colored heat map, and it shows that the green color shows the higher expression, while the red color, lighter red color, shows the lower expression. And it shows that cycloartenol synthase was the highest expressing and expressing gene during these developmental stages, and the bud developmental stages were the highly active stages for vedenolite biosynthesis. So after that, we wanted to know which of the pathway is involved for biosynthesis of vedenolites. For that, we used carbon 13 to monitor the vedenolite biogenesis, and we fed this culture to actively growing cultures, one for control and another with the carbon 13, and we extracted vedenolites, and their equal level of vedenolites was confirmed by radio TLC and HPLC. And then their carbon 13 NMR was performed to know the carbon abundance at each position of the vedenolites of their 28 carbon numbers. So carbon abundance was measured in percentage, and their incorporation was measured as a relative carbon percentage. The percentage which was lower than 1 or 1 was negligible. And then their position also determined the vedenolite biosynthesis pathway. So when we started, we used carbon 1 radioactivity. So we know if they have plastid origin, they have different, they have radioactivity at different positions. And if they have they have a lineage from cytosol, they have radioactivity at different positions. So positions of carbon determine their route, and their abundance in NMR determines their contribution in the biosynthesis. So when we integrated this vidanolite having radioactivity from the two pathway, we found that both of the pathways are involved in the biosynthesis of this molecule. Higher with mevalonate pathway, because we can see there is higher carbon abundance was found, while lower with DOXP pathway. So we calculated their percentage contribution, and we found that this pathway has 75% role, while other is 25% role. Then after, we wanted to know the regulation of vidanolite biosynthesis. For that, we use two kinds of inhibitor to at the two rate limiting step of vidanolite biosynthesis. One is HMGR and another is squalene epoxidase step. So HMGR was inhibited by pervastatin, which is a well-known statin drug to inhibit the cholesterol biosynthesis in animals. And squalene epoxidase was inhibited by terbinafine, an antifungal drug, to inhibit the ergosterol biosynthesis in fungi. So when we incorporated at two different concentrations in shoot cultures of Vidania, and we found that biosynthesis of vidanolite was affected in the presence of in these two inhibitors. The inhibition was more prominent in the presence of terbinafine, which is this inhibition of this step, in comparison to this step. So why it is like that? So we concluded that maybe because the IPP molecule, which is inhibited by HMGR inhibition, is maybe compensated by plastid pathway. As our previous study, we know that this pathway has also involvement in the biosynthesis of vidanolites. So the other biosynthetic pathway putative genes were also semi-quantitatively expressed in this tissue system, and we found there was no effect on GTs, and while the cycloartenol synthase has a lower expression in higher concentration of inhibitors, we found a very interesting pattern of HMGR expression, that in the presence of inhibitor of this squalene epoxidase step, we found the overexpression of HMGR here, which can suggest a feedback regulation of biosynthesis. By stopping this, they can enhance the expression of HMGR to have more precursor for biosynthetic pathway. So after studying the biosynthesis and the accumulation study in whole plant level, we wanted to know if the cell culture of Vidania is useful for biotransformation for more value-added products, or also salt stress, what is the salt stress response of plants of Vidania somnifera. For biotransformation studies, we used two substrates, artemisinin and vidanolites. We added artemisinin to the cell culture of Vidania, and we found that there is another product, another derivative of artemisinin was synthesized by the cell culture, and it was deoxyartemisinin, which is because of the breakage of the peroxide bridge here, and we assume that there must be some non-specific peroxidase enzyme present in the cell culture. So we partially purified the extracts of Vidania and by ammonium sulfate, and we found that the that fraction has more potential to transform artemisinin to deoxyartemisinin as compared to the crude extracts. In another study of biotransformation, we use vidanolites, different vidanolites to the cell culture of vidania, and we found while addition of vidanolite A, they converted to the vidanol, and they have the similar structure, but only they are different at the this hydroxyl group, the position of this hydroxyl group. So we know that they have the cell culture of vidania is not only have the potential to biosynthesize the secondary metabolite, but they also have potential to biotransform the molecules to their high value products. So for salt stress to shoots and callus, we apply different concentrations of five different salts to shoot and callus culture of vidania, and we found that in the presence of calcium chloride, the growth of vidania was highly inhibited, while in the presence of sodium chloride and potassium nitrate at lower level, it was shoots looked more healthier. So we found that vidania was not so affected by the salt stress. They were moderately tolerant to this stress, and we wanted to know what is the mechanism of the plant to cope up in the salt stress condition. For that, we estimated the total metabolites on the shoots, and we found that all chlorophyll and carotenoids were reduced in all conditions, while total vidanolites were also reduced, except at lower concentration of sodium chloride, which enhanced the production of secondary metabolites. Then after we estimated the other metabolites, which are reported to be important for stress to cope up the plant in stress condition, like reducing sugar and phenolics and proline, and we found they were highly present in the shoots and also in the callus culture. Then we did antioxidant enzyme assay of catalase, glycol peroxidase, ascorbic peroxidase, polyphenol oxidase, lipid peroxidase, and glutathione reductase in shoots and in callus also. And we found that overall, all the antioxidant enzymes have high activity in the cultures under the salt stress conditions. So we wanted to know here if their high activity is due to the highly reactive enzyme, or there are new isoforms induced by the stress condition. For that, we did isozymic profiling of antioxidants enzymes and two housekeeping enzymes, esterase and diaphorase. We found that in stress condition, callus cultures lost the diaphorase 4, and in superoxide dismutase, we found a very interesting result that in shoots there was new isoform was present of copper and zinc SOD isoform, which is mainly associated to the blastid. That's why they are not present in the callus, because the callus has poorly developed blastids. But the iron SOD has a new isoform in the presence of salt stress. So now, in conclusion, we know that our plant has vidanolite accumulation at different level, and they have highest accumulation in shoots, followed by buds, and then berries and roots have lower expression with the similar concentration. And in biosynthetic pathway, we know that this pathway has 75% involvement, while the other pathway has 25% involvement. And these genes are this gene can be a candidate putative gene for biosynthesis of vidania. And there is a feedback regulation was observed in, from squalene epoxidase step to HMGR step. And also we found that the Vidania plant is moderately tolerant to the salt by enhancing the production of antioxidant enzymes and metabolites. And these cells has potential for biotransformation. I was also part of other works carrying out in of my lab from another medicinal plants of Centella asiatica, Gymnema, and Artemisinin. For that, for the work on our Vidania, work on carried out on the plant of Vidania somnifera, we got award from Council of Scientific and Research, Industrial Research, which was received by my previous supervisors, R.S. Sangwan and N.S. Sangwan. I'm thankful to my previous department of Metabolic and Structural Biology Lab, NIMITLI and Council of Scientific and Industrial Research for fellowship. I would also like to thanks to LIF Seminar Committee for providing this opportunity to talk about my work. And I would like to thanks to Nane and Katrina for introducing me another world of East to work with the Plantech Corporation.